الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى خصوصا على افضلهم وخاتم النبيين محمد الامين وعلى اله وصحبه اجمعين اما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى كما ورد في سورة المائده اعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لعن الذين كفروا من بني اسرائيل على لسان داوود وعيسى ابن مريم ذلك بما عصوا وكانوا يعتدون كانوا لا يتناهون عن منكر فعلوه لبئس ما كانوا يفعلون صدق الله العظيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي اللهم ربنا الهمنا رشدنا واعذنا من شرور انفسنا اللهم ارنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وارنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه اللهم وفقنا لما تحب وترضى اللهم انس وحشتنا في قبورنا وارحمنا بالقران العظيم اللهم اجعله لنا اماما ونورا وهدى ورحمه اللهم ذكرنا منه ما نسينا وعلمنا منه ما جهلنا وارزقنا تلاوته آناء الليل وآناء النهار واجعله لنا حجة يا رب العالمين آمين Dear brothers and sisters and sons and daughters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. By the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are beginning the study of Surah Al-Maidah from ayah number 78 today. لُعِنَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ The discourse regarding the people of the book, the Jews and the Christians is continuing. Now a very strong word is coming here. لُعِنَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ عَلَىٰ لِسَانِ دَابُودَ وَعِيسَ بْنِ مَرْيَمِ Those from Bani Israel who disbelieved or who didn't have the real faith. It's not necessary that this kufr may be always legal form. The real kufr, I have emphasized this point. Legal iman, real iman. Legal kufr, real kufr. Legal irtidad and real irtidad. These things should be very clear. Because generally we pass from these verse, you know, and these ayat, keeping only the legal aspect in our mind. And that becomes a hindrance, an obstruction in reaching the essence of the ayat. To those of Bani Israel, because as a whole they were a Muslim ummah. Legally they were not kafirs. But actually, if we see to the real iman, the real faith, most of them were lacking it, just as we today are lacking it. We are Muslims. We profess to be Muslims. We are testifying, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Everything is okay. We are Muslims. But how many of us have the real iman? It's absolutely different issue. You know, there's one proof of it, which nobody can refute, that the great majority of the Muslims today are not mu'mins. What's the proof? We read the ayah in Surah Al-Imran, وَلَا تَهِنُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا وَأَنْتُمُ الْعَلَوْنَ إِن كُنْتُمْ مُؤْمِنِينَ Don't be grieved, O Muslims. We promise to you, you will be supreme, you will dominate, only if you are mu'mins. And we are not dominating. We are being trampled down under the feet of others. We are controlled by others. Our resources are actually in their own hands now. Only, apparently, we are free. We have 60 or more free Muslim countries in the world. Can we really point out to a country which is really free? That means we are not Muslims. Two and two go to make four. There can be no escape from it. The same was the case with Bani Israel. They were a Muslim ummah, no doubt. But the majority of them lacked the real iman. And now here a very strong word is used. Lu'ina. They were cursed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we find a stronger words. Dhurebat alayhimu zillatu wal maskanatu wabahu bi ghadabi min Allah. These are the wordings from Suratul Baqarah. There are, you know, nearly the same wordings appear with a little difference in Suratul Al Imran. And we can see our own picture in this mirror. Dhurebat alayna azillatu wal maskana. Al yawm. Today, we are the humiliated ones. Humiliation has been heaped upon us. Anyhow, lu'ina, cursed. They were cursed. Cursed by whom? Allah. But Allah doesn't speak directly to everybody. Ala lisan Dawood wa Isa ibn Maryam. On the tongue of Dawood alayhi salatu wa salam and Isa, son of Mary. They cursed. And we can find in the Gospels how Hazrat Masih alayhi salatu wa salam criticized the Jews. You are like serpents. You are like graves in which there is nothing but decayed bones. But above the grave you have a very good white color and white cloth. In the same way, you pose to be very pious people, religious people, Rabbaniyun. But actually within you is hidden a character, extremely mean character. So that was the plight of Bani Israel. And same is ours. لُعِنَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ عَلَى لِسَانِ دَاوُدَ وَعِيسَى ابْنِ مَرْيَمَ ذَلِكَ بِمَا عَصَوْا وَكَانُوا يَعْتَدُونَ. And this was not without any cause. This was because they had been transgressing, disobeying. عَصَوْا مَعْصِيَا وَكَانُوا يَعْتَدُونَ. They were transgressing the limits. كَانُوا لَا يَتَنَاهَوْنَ. And one of their very big shortcomings. And again, don't feel offended. I will invite you to see whether we are not doing the same. Kanu la yatanahawna an munkarin fa'alu. They didn't forbid each other from the wrong things which they were doing. Because when a nation or a community as a whole goes down, they have a gentleman agreement among themselves. You don't criticize me, I won't criticize you. Let us make that arrangement. كَانُوا لَا يَتَنَاهَوْنَا عَنْ مُنْكَرٍ فَعَلُوا. They were not forbidding each other on the wrong things they were committing. لَبَيْسَ مَا كَانُوا يَفْعَلُونَ. Definitely, it was very evil what they were doing. تَرَى كَثِيرًا مِنْهُ يَتَوَلَّوْنَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. You will see many of them making friends and taking them as protectors. Whom? Alladhina kafaru. Here kafaru means something else. The idolaters. The people of Arabia who were worshipping idols. The associators with Allah, the pagan Arabs. They used to say, well, they are on a better level than these Muslims. This is the extremism of enmity they had against Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Muslims. تَرَا كَثِيرًا مِّنْهُمْ يَتَوَلَّوْنَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَبِيْسَ مَا قَدَّمَتْ لَهُمْ أَنفُسُهُمْ. Surely, very evil and bad is what their souls have sent forward for themselves. This is Iman bil-Akhirah. Whatever we are doing, we are sending it for ourselves. You shall find it in the hereafter. لَبِيْسَ مَا قَدَّمَتْ لَهُمْ أَنفُسُهُمْ. Their own ids and libidos and baser selves. They are sending, what they are sending? The stocks they are gathering in the hereafter. They are very bad. Ansakhit Allahu alayhim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been angered upon them. Wa fil azabihum khalidun. And they will abide forever in the punishment, in the chastisement. Walau kanu yu'minuna billahi wan nabiyyi. Had they believed really in Allah and this Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa manzila ilayhi, and what has been sent down to him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, mattakhaduhum awliya, they would not have made friends with these pagans and idolaters. Walakinna kaseeran minhum fasiqoon. But most of them are actually themselves transgressors. So they are making friendship with them. Now a very important subject is coming. A difference of behavior of these two groups of the people of the book. The Jews were bitter, most enemies. And bracketed them are the idolaters, the pagans, who openly associate others with Allah. On the contrary, the attitude of the Christians as a whole at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was absolutely different. Although not many of them embraced Islam, except for the people in Abyssinia. But you know, the letters of invitation which were sent to them, most of them honored the letters of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They were very lukewarm. Heraclius even intended to accept Islam. But he only wanted that the whole Roman Empire should be converted to Islam today, as 300 years ago, Constantine the emperor, Roman emperor, had converted, and the whole empire had converted. So that the system remained the same. Constantine remained the emperor. Had he alone embraced Islam, he would have to abdicate the throne. So that was where he failed, when people didn't agree. Otherwise, he had recognized Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he is the person. About him we find prophecies in the Old Testament as well as the New Testament. Anyhow, the difference, لَتَجَدَنَّ أَشَدَّ النَّاسِ عَدَاوَةً لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا الْيَهُودِ وَالَّذِينَ أَشْرَكُوا. You'll surely find the most vehement of the people in hostility and enmity towards those who believe in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, al-Yahud, the Jews, wal-lazina ashraku, and with them are bracketed the idolaters. Today also we find Israel and Bharat, how much closer to each other. This ayah is speaking for itself. وَلَتَجَدَنَّ أَقْرَبَهُمْ مَوَدَّةً لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّا نَصَارَى. And you will find the closest to them in affection and love those who call themselves Nasara. ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّ مِنْهُمْ قِسِّيسِينَ وَرُهْبَانًا. And this is because among them there are priests, true priests, sincere priests. And رُهْبَانًا, there are monks. وَأَنَّهُمْ لَا يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ. And this is because they do not take to arrogance and haughtiness. They are not proud. Now these conditions have absolutely changed. These were the conditions at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now the conditions have changed. Although they have changed temporarily, but even temporary, in Allah's calendar, because one day is 1,000 years, so even half day may be 500 years, the things started changing nearly 500 years ago or 400 years ago with the advent of Protestantism, then division of Christianity, then the gradual control of Jews over the Christians. And at this time, this process has reached its zenith. Although there are some voices of dissent, which you might be hearing from the southern states of the United States and the western part, the militias, etc., etc., people like them, some voices of dissension. But practically, the whole Christian world is under the thumb of the Jews, the Zionists. And Christians have lost their identity, at least for the time being. But things will change. We also believe in the second advent of Jesus. He will be coming. They also believe in it. And we have been told by Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then Christians will close to Muslims, come close, close and closer. No difference will remain and both will become one. Islam will be the deen of these Christians also. So just as we found that in this world, the munafiqeen were bracketed with Muslims, with mu'mins, In the hereafter, they will be bracketed with the kuffar, the unbelievers. In the same way, today, Christians and Jews are bracketed together. But before the end of this world, things are going to change. I can't say when. I can't give you the timetable. But this must happen. These are clear prophecies. Before that, the whole of the Christian world is going to wage a very big war against the Muslims, which they call Armageddon. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said, named it Al-Malhamatul Uzma, the greatest war of human history. And you might be hearing these slogans from these Christians, Armageddon is coming. Jesus is coming, Armageddon is coming. This Armageddon, it is going to be a very big war, with very high casualties of the Muslims. In one of these we find the words that a crow will fly and fly and fly for the whole day. He won't find even a single inch on the land without a dead body to come down. After being exhausted, it will fall on a dead body. 999 out of every 1,000 will be killed. These are the words of the hadith. You can find these ahadiths in the Kitabul Malahim and Kitabul Fitan. In every collection of ahadiths, you have these chapters. Anyhow. But after that, tables will be turned, that Jesus will come down, and the leader will appear among the Muslims, Mahdi, and by their cooperation and helping each other, and some armies will come from the east to help Mahdi, and then the things will be changed. And then, you know, the Jews will be eradicated, eliminated altogether, and Christians will become Muslims. So that will be the end, inshallah. But anyhow, actually this is the condition which was there at the time of the Prophet. وَإِذَا سَمِعُوا مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَى الرَّسُولِ تَرَى أَعْيُنَهُمْ تَفِيضُ مِنَ الدَّمْعِ. This ayah refers to an incident. This migration towards Habsha took place before the migration to Medina. So many Muslims went there. Then there was a controversy, an argument. Then Najashi Nagus, he said, okay, what Muhammad has said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what Quran has said, is absolutely correct. So many people there, including himself, they accepted Islam. And a few years after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Muslims, they migrated to Medina, a deputation of 70 new Muslims, converts, who were Christians before, now they were Muslims, they came over to Medina. And here, when Quran was read out to them, they were so much moved by it that their eyes overflowed with tears. They were also Christians previously. وَإِذَا سَمِعُوا مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَى الرَّسُولِ. And when they heard and listened to what was sent down on the Messenger of Allah, تَرَى عَيُنَهُمْ, you see, you look to their eyes, تَفِيضُ مِنَ الدَّمْ, they are overflowing with tears. مِمَّا عَرَفُوا مِنَ الْحَقِّ. Because of the truth that they recognized. And in our souls, they recognize the truth. And they are moved then. And our emotion. And as a sign of that motivation, tears come to your eyes. يَقُولُونَ رَبَّنَا آمَنَّا فَاكْتُبْنَا مَعَ الشَّاهِدِينَ. And they are crying out, oh, our Lord, we believe. So please write down our names among your witnesses. Witnesses of Allah. كُنُوا قَوَّامِينَ لِلَّهِ شُهَدَاءَ بِالْقِسْطِ. كُنُوا قَوَّامِينَ بِالْقِسْطِ شُهَدَاءَ لِلَّهِ. So please write down our names also among those who testify. وَمَا لَنَا لَا نُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَمَا جَاءَنَا مِنَ الْحَقِّ. And why shouldn't we believe in Allah and what has reached us from the truth? وَنَطْمَعُ أَن يُدْخِلَنَا رَبُّنَا مَعَ الْقَوْمِ الصَّالِحِينَ. And we very much eagerly desire that our Lord admits us and joins us with the company of the pious and the righteous people. In the hereafter, we are joined together with them. فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءِ وَالصَّالِحِينَ. فَأَصَابَهُمُ اللَّهُ بِمَا قَالُوا جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارُ. So Allah rewarded them due to this saying of theirs, the gardens underneath which rivers are flowing. Khalidina fiha, abiding there forever. Wadhalika jazaul mursaleen. And this is really the reward and recompense for the good doers, for the muhsineen. Now what actually is meant by muhsineen in Quran will come very soon in an ayah. This word is mostly misunderstood by Muslims. Ihsan, we only know doing good to others. This is also one meaning of the word. But ihsan actually, as a term of Islam, is making your religion more beautiful, your attachment to Allah more strong, so that your behavior as a mu'min becomes more and more and more beautiful. Husn. Min husnil islamil mar'i tarkuhu ma la yani. It's a very good hadith which came to my mind. It's a beauty of the Islam of a person that he should give up everything which is useless, giving no benefit. Your time is very precious. Either you have to use it for fulfilling some requirements of this worldly life, you are earning, okay, it's a need. Or you spend it for earning something for the hereafter. Only whiling away time, pastimes, just killing the time. This doesn't become of a Muslim who knows that every moment of today is going to become eternal in the hereafter. The reward of this limited life is going to be repaid to us in the unlimited life. Can there be any ratio between the finite and the infinite? No ratio. So every moment of this life also is so important. So ihsan means beautifying your religion, your character, your behavior as the bondsman of Allah. But this ayah will come very soon. وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا وَكَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِنَا أُولَٰئِكَ أَصْحَابُ الْجَحِيمِ. Same thing, you know, the contrast always. When there is the mention of mu'mins, then what will be the end and lot of the unbelievers? As for those who disbelieve and belie our signs and ayat, they are the companions of hellfire. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُحَرِّمُوا طَيِّبَاتِ مَا أَحَلَّ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ وَلَا تَعْتَدُوا. O you who believe, don't declare as unlawful, forbidden, whatever is pure, whatever is good. مَا أَحَلَّ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ, which Allah has declared as permissible. وَلَا تَعْتَدُوا. Don't exceed the limits. Now this is another extreme form. When somebody becomes over-pious, over muttaqi, then they are not using even the permissible things. So to take something which is haram and make it halal for you is a big crime. But equally big crime is to make something, to declare something haram which is lawful. If you declare a halal haram, or if you declare a haram halal, both are equal. So one must be very cautious. Don't be extremist. Don't go to the other end. Inna Allah la yuhibbul mu'tadin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't like those who exceed the limits. We find in Quran, even the Prophet himself was admonished. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ya ayyuhal nabi, lima tuharrimu ma ahallallahu lak tabtaghi mardata azwajik. Oh Prophet, why are you declaring for yourself as haram what Allah has made permissible for you? Whatever is permissible, never go to the other extreme. وَكُلُوا مِمَّا رَضَقَكُمُ اللَّهُ حَلَالًا طَيِّبًا. And do it what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. And if it is halal and tayyib, pure and clean and permissible. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ الَّذِي أَنْتُمْ بِهِ مُؤْمِنُونَ. And have taqwa. Always remain conscious of Allah, on whom you have the belief and faith. If you profess to have the belief, you remain unmindful of him, unconscious of him. Now, this reminds me of a saying of a saint, although he was illiterate. But he was a very pious person. I remember him. He has died now. He used to say, Jo dam ghafil, so dam kafir. The moments that you pass unmindful of Allah, these moments you have passed as unbelievers, not believers. Never be unmindful of Allah. Allah should remain at the conscious level every moment. So this is another definition of kufr and Islam. If you are unmindful of Allah, really this time has passed in a sort of kufr. Jo dam ghafil, la yu'akhidhukum Allahu bil-laghwi fi yamanikum. Allah is not going to take you to task regarding your unintentional oaths. And this is the habit of our Arab brethren. Wallahi, billahi. They won't start a single sentence without wallahi. What is this wallah? Are you taking an oath? Are you declaring on oath and swearing? But it is just a word of common use. They don't mean it. So this is laghv. La yu'akhidhukum Allahu bil-laghwi fi yamanikum. Allah is not going to. He is not such a hard taskmaster. He will just ignore. Unintentional. وَلَكِ يُعَاخِذُكُمْ مِمَا عَقَدْتُمُ الْأَيْمَانِ. But any oath that you take seriously, intentionally, well, that will be accounted for. Now, if you don't fulfill it, you are doing a sin. فَكَفَّارَتُهُ. If you want to break such an oath, there is an expiation. And what is that? إِطْعَامُ عَشْرَةِ مَسَاكِينَ. Feed 10 poor people. مِنْ أَوْسَطِ مَا تُطْعِمُونَ أَهْلِيكُمْ. But this should be the average food that you give to your family. Not that you are using 6-course dinners and you give them some loaves of bread and something, go, and number is complete. 10 people, I have fed them. No. مِنْ أَوْسَطِ مَا تُطْعِمُونَ أَهْلِيكُمْ أَوْ كِسْوَتُهُمْ. Or you give them the clothing to these 10 persons. أَوْ تَحْرِيرُ رَقَبَةٍ. Or setting free one slave. And here it is not essential that he should be Muslim or Mu'min. فَمَنْ لَمْ يَجِدْ فَسَيَامُ سَلَاسَةِ أَيَّامٍ. Whosoever can't afford it, so he have to keep fasting for 3 days. ذَلِكَ كَفَّارَةُ أَيْمَانِكُمْ. This is the expiation for your oaths. إِذَا حَلَفْتُمْ. When you have taken them seriously. وَحْفَظُوا أَيْمَانَكُمْ. And you must protect and keep your oaths. كَذَلِكَ يُبَيِّنُ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ آيَاتِهِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. In this way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes His commandments clear to you so that you should be thankful to Him. He's clearing everything. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِنَّمَا الْخَمْرُ وَالْمَيْسِرُ وَالْأَنْصَابُ وَالْأَزْلَامُ رِجْسٌ مِنْ عَمَلِ الشَّيْطَانِ. O you who believe, verily wine and gambling and sacrificing to the idols and deciding about things or knowing luck through arrows, using the arrows, this is also a form of gambling. رِجْسٌ مِنْ عَمَلِ الشَّيْطَانِ. They are Shaitan's handiwork, Satan's handiwork, abomination. Fajtanibu, so refrain from these things. La'allakum tuflihun, so that you can prosper. You can prosper spiritually. You can prosper in Iman. You can go higher up. From Islam to Iman or from Iman to Ihsan. إِنَّمَا يُرِيدِ الشَّيْطَانُ وَنْ يُوْقِعَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْعَدَابَةَ وَالْبَغْضَاءَ فِي الْخَمْرِ وَالْمَيْسِرِ. Now there were 4 things in the former ayah. Repetition is coming only for 2. إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ الشَّيْطَانُ وَنْ يُوْقِعَ بَيْنَكُمُ الْعَدَابَةَ وَالْبَغْضَاءَ فِي الْخَمْرِ وَالْمَيْسِرِ. Repetition is for wine and gambling. Why these 2 things are bracketed? You find these 2 things bracketed in Surah Al-Baqarah. يَسَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْخَمْرِ وَالْمَيْسِرِ قُلْ فِيهِمَا إِسْمٌ كَبِيرٌ وَمَنَافِعُ لِلنَّاسِ وَإِسْمُهُمَا أَكْبَرُ مِنْ نَفْعِهِمَا. But if you are breaking something, there must be something common. What is common? Why does a man take wine or liquor? Because he wants to shun the bitter realities of life. Just take it. You are not ready to face the bitter realities of life. Main kade ki raah se hokar guzar gaya. Varna safar hayat ka behad taweel tha. The easy way. And what is gambling? Shirking hard work. Not trying to earn through hard work. That's by chance. Both things are common. Shunning the bitter realities and shirking hard work. One is khamr, the other is gambling. And the other thing which is common has been given here. إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ الشَّيْطَانَ يُوْقِيَ بَيْرَكُمُ الْعَدَاوَةُ وَالْبَغْضَى. Verily, Satan wants to precipitate amongst you hatred and enmity. When you are not in your senses, you don't know what you are saying. So there will be disputes, you will quarrel, you will be shouting. And this thing can sow the seeds of some permanent enmity also. In the same way, gamblers, if one is losing and losing and losing it, now he becomes furious. And what happens in the gambling dens, most of people know. Because if somebody is earning and he has worked for it, although he has earned something from you, okay, you don't grudge. But when you see he is earning, earning without any labor, I am losing, losing without any fault of mine, then he is enraged. إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ الشَّيْطَانُ أَنْ يُوْقِيَ بَيْنَكُمُ الْعَدَاوَةَ وَالْبَغْضَاءَ فِي الْخَمْرِ وَالْمَيْسَرِ وَيَصُدَّكُمْ عَنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. And he wants to bar you from the remembrance of Allah, وَعَنِ السَّلَاةِ, and from the salah and the prayer. فَلَنْتُمْ مُنْتَهُونَ. Now this is a very stern way of addressing. How are you stopping or not? Because this is the final pronouncement regarding wine in Quran. وَاتِيُوا اللَّهَ وَاتِيُوا الرَّسُولَ. And obey Allah and His Messenger. And obey His Messenger. وَعْزَرُوا. Hizr is protection. وَخُذُوا حِذْرَكُمْ. Protect yourself. Protect your souls. If you disobey Allah and His Messenger, you are putting yourself in disaster. You are throwing yourself, with your own hands into the fire of hell. This is a very beautiful hadith which comes to my mind. The Prophet said, "Kullu ummati yadkhulun al-jannata illa man aba." All of my ummat will enter paradise except those who themselves refuse. Now it was a mode of expression, you know, so that people get excited. Themselves refuse to enter Jannah. وَقِيلَ وَمَنْ أَبَى. And people asked naturally, who will refuse? Who are those who refuse to enter Jannah? Now the answer came, مَنْ أَتَانِي دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ وَمَنْ عَصَانِي فَقَدْ أَبَى. Whosoever obeys me, he enters Jannah. And who disobeys, he has refused to enter Jannah. This is the way he taught. وَاتِيُوا اللَّهَ وَاتِيُوا الرَّسُولَ وَاحْذَرُوا فَإِنْ تَوَلَّيْتُمْ فَاعْلَمُوا أَنَّمَا عَلَى رَسُولِنَا الْبَلَاغُ الْمُبِينُ. And if you turn your backs, let it be known to you that the responsibility of our messenger is only to convey to you. He will not be responsible for you on the day of judgment. If he has done his duty, he has conveyed. Now just recall the ayah which we read last night. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ بَلِّغْ مَا أَنزَلَ إِلَيْكَ مِنْ رَبِّكَ وَإِنْ لَمْ تَفْعَلْ فَمَا بَلَّغْتَ رِسَالَتَهُ. On the one hand, that stern warning. You do your duty in full. But when you have done your duty, now you are absolved of the responsibility. فَعْلَمُوا. Let it be known to you, let it be clear to you. إِنَّمَا عَلَى رَسُولِنَا الْبَلَاغُ الْمُبِينَ. On our messenger, the responsibility is only of conveying to you the message. لَيْسَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. This is a very profound hadith regarding the hikmah and the philosophy and the wisdom of the Quran. لَيْسَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ جُنَاهٌ فِي مَا تَعِيمُوا. There is no blame on those people who have come to believe and have been doing good deeds, on what they had eaten or drunk before. Because when these ayats were revealed, people, you know, became very much thoughtful. What will happen to us? If it is rijsun min amali shaitan, we have been taking it. Maybe someone among them had accepted Islam at the age of 60. He was consuming alcohol and wine throughout his life. Because in Arabian civilization also, this wine was just as a part of their food as it is in the West. They were accustomed to it. Now they thought that, you know, each and every cell of my body must have wine in it. I have been consuming so much wine. What will happen to me? It means I am, whole of my body is now rich. That was their concern. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is alleviating their concern. No. Till such time that we declared finally that it is forbidden, whatever you have drunk or eaten, there is no blame on you. So that is the subject of the ayah. But now, what is coming next is the most important, profound. إِذَا مَتَّقَوْا وَآمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ سُمَّ اتَّقَوْا وَآمَنُوا سُمَّ اتَّقَوْا وَأَحْسَنُوا وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. This is the ayah which gives you three stations in Islam. Legal iman, real iman, and ihsan. The same three questions were asked to the Prophet by Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam, and you find it in the hadith of Jibreel, the Umm Sunnah. Akhbirni anil Islam, akhbirni anil iman, akhbirni anil ihsan. Legal iman is Islam. We are Muslims, we are legally mu'min. Real iman is the conviction if you really have it. May Allah give us all that conviction, that real belief, that yaqeen. Ilm al-yaqeen at least. And then highest level is ihsan. What is ihsan? أَن تَعْبُدَ اللَّهَ كَأَنَّكَ تَرَاهُ فَإِن لَمْ تَكُن تَرَاهُ فَإِنَّهُ يَرَاكُ. That your belief in Allah's existence and presence reaches that level of conviction as if you are seeing Him with your own eyes. And if not that, you must have a feeling that He is seeing you and you are in His presence. أَن تَعْبُدَ اللَّهَ كَأَنَّكَ تَرَاهُ. But this hadith has been narrated by so many sahaba. Hazrat Umar, Abdullah ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Abbas, Abu Huraira. And there are slight differences in wordings. So let me give you three things here. أَن تَعْبُدَ اللَّهَ كَأَنَّكَ تَرَاهُ. أَن تَخْشَ اللَّهَ كَأَنَّكَ تَرَاهُ. أَن تَعْمَلَ لِلَّهِ كَأَنَّكَ تَرَاهُ. فَإِن لَمْ تَكُن تَرَاهُ فَإِنَّهُ يَرَاكُ. You worship Allah as if you see Him. You fear Allah as if you see Him. You work for Allah, you strive for Allah with such an intensity as if you are seeing. This is ihsan. Now we find there are three stations, three levels. But the driving force, what will take me from the first to the second? Taqwa. What will take me from the second to the third? Taqwa. How beautifully this taqwa is being repeated here. لَيْسَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ جُنَاهٌ فِي مَا تَعِمُوا إِذَا مَتَّقَوْا وَآمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ ثُمَّ اتَّقَوْا وَآمَنُوا ثُمَّ اتَّقَوْا وَأَحْسَنُوا وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. Three levels, you have to climb step by step. لَتَرْكَبُنَّ طَبَقًا عَن طَبَقٍ. But you need some effort to go higher up. And you know the pushing force, the motivating force, the driving force is taqwa. Here I differ from Maulana Maududi. He has written a very good book, a very small pamphlet, but very profound. He has taken them to be four stations. Iman, Taqwa, Islam, Ihsan. According to this ayah, Taqwa is not a station. Taqwa is not a level. It's the continually driving force. Stations are only three. Islam or legal Iman. Then real Iman. Then Ihsan. But anyhow, the subject matter of that booklet is very good, very profound. But here it's better, because taqwa is repeated three times here. It is the driving force. And second point which this ayah clears very much is the difference of opinion between Imam Abu Hanifa and Imam Bukhari rahimahumullah. Imam Abu Hanifa says that Iman and Amal Salih, they are two separate entities. Imam Bukhari says, no, Iman and Amal Salih are one organic whole. Both are 100% correct. How? Apparently, these statements are self-contradictory. But one is speaking about the legal Iman. Imam Abu Hanifa is a jurist. He looks to the legal sides of the matter. At the legal level, Iman is separate, Amal is separate. Amal is not part of Iman. But at the real level, they amalgamate with each other. They become an organic whole. This is what you find here. At the legal level, izamat taqaw wa amanu wa amilu salihat. Summat taqaw wa amanu. Now the amal salih is not mentioned here again, because now it has become an integral part of Iman. They have mixed with each other as an organic whole, inseparable. La yanfaq. Wallahu yuhibbul mursaneen. And whosoever reaches that level of Ihsan, well, he becomes the beloved of Allah. May Allah give us at least the courage to make a firm resolve to rise to that level. If you have the intention, Allah will open ways for you. If we have only the progress in business and profession, having more and more property and so on, well, Allah will give you. But if now you change your field of ambitions, I want to go this way. I am a legal Muslim. And this is also by the grace of Allah that I was born to Muslim parents. But I won't be contented with this station. I'll go to real Iman. And then not only to real Iman, but to Ihsan. May Allah bless us. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu la yabluwannakumullahu bishay'in minas sayyidi. Oh, you who believe, Allah will surely test you with a game, hunting. Tanaluhu aydikum wa rimahukum, because it was declared to be unlawful, forbidden, to hunt something and to have a game when you are in ihram. You are wearing the sacred robes of Hajj and Umrah. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we will test you. Sometimes you will find that some very beautiful deer is within your reach. You can just catch him by your arm. Or it is in the reach of your arrows or spears. So it will be a test whether you refrain, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not allowed me, I am in ihram. Or whether you are tempted. Oh, this is so near, so easy. Catch hold of it. Get it. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu la yabluwannakumullahu bishay'in minas sayyidi tanaluhu aydikum wa rimahukum. Your hands, your arms, your spears, they reach them. Liya'lamallahu man yakhafuhu bilghayb. So that Allah should come to know. And He wants to make it clear. Who fears Him unseen? He believes in an unseen Allah. And he thinks nobody is seeing me when I'm doing this. But because he believes that Allah is seeing me. This is Iman bil Ghaib. In the very beginning, you know, we find in Surah Al-Baqarah, وَذَلِّ الْمُتَّقِينَ الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ فَمَنِ اعْتَدَى بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ فَلَهُ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. Whosoever transgresses after this, for him is a painful chastisement. يَا أَيُّهَا آمَنُوا لَا تَقْتُلُوا الصَّيْدَ وَأَنْتُمْ حُرُمٌ. Again, repetition. Don't kill any game. When you are muhrim, you are wearing those robes of ihram. وَمَنْ قَتَلَهُ مِنْكُمْ مُتَعَمِّدًا. And if someone of you kills some game knowingly, intentionally, فَجَزَاؤُهُ مِثْلُ مَا قَتَلَ مِنَ النَّعَمِ. Now the penalty is an animal which should be like the animal that he has hunted. If it was a deer, a goat will suffice. it was a bigger something, then you'll have to sacrifice a cow. The size of the animal that he has hunted. And who will decide it? Yahkumu bihi dhawa adli minkum. Two just men must decide from amongst you that now you have done it, so the penalty is that you sacrifice a goat or a cow or so on as a penalty. Hadiyam balighal Kaaba. It's going to be present to reach Kaaba. Aw kaffaratun. And if you can't do it, you can't purchase a goat or a cow to sacrifice as a penalty. Kaffaratun ta'amu masakina wa adlun zalika siyamin li yazuqa wa bala amrihi. Now you have to feed the poor people. What should be the number of people? It will be decided. How many men can be fed on one goat or sheep? Those men feed them. Or, aw adlu zalika siyaman. Or the same number you keep fast. If you can't feed people, you don't have money. If you know the penalty was to be a goat, it could suffice for 20 people. Then 20 days fasting is, you know, kaffara. لِيَزُوْقَ وَبَالَ عَمْرَهِ. So that he may taste the consequence of what he has done. أَفَ اللَّهُ عَمَّا سَلَفْ. What has happened in fast? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has pardoned it. What is gone? Gone. وَمَنْ عَادَ فَيَنْتَقِمُ اللَّهُ مِنْهُ. Now whosoever repeats it again, after the declaration of these final laws, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take retribution from him. And Wallahu azizun intiqam. And Allah is aziz, all powerful. And is lord of retribution. Uhilla lakum sayadul bahr. But there is an exception. If you are traveling in a river or a sea, in a boat, uhilla lakum sayadul bahr. Wata'amuhu wata'al lakum walissayyara. Because conditions can be very different while you are on sea. Nothing to eat. Nothing else. So there, you know, hunting of the sea, fishing, it is permissible. And eating it is okay. Mata'an lakum, provision for you and for the travelers. Wa lisayyara wa hurrim alaykum saydul barri ma'adultum hurman. As long as you are in ihram, this hunting of the land is prohibited to you. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ الَّذِي إِلَيْهِ تُحْشَرُونَ. And have taqwa of Allah, to whom you will be gathered together. In His presence you will have to stand. جَعَلَ اللَّهُ الْكَعْبَةَ الْبَيْتَ الْحَرَامَ قِيَامًا لِلنَّاسِ وَالشَّهْرَ الْحَرَامَ وَالْهَدِيَ وَالْقَلَائِدِ. Now these words came in the very beginning also. Now Allah confirms it, reconfirming it. Allah has declared Kaaba. جَعَلَ اللَّهُ الْكَعْبَةَ الْبَيْتَ الْحَرَامَ. This is the sacred house. In the same way, it is a qiyaman linnas. It is a support and security for people. Whosoever enters it, مَنْ دَخَلَهُ كَانَ آمِنًا. وَشَهْرَ الْحَرَامِ. In the same way, Allah has declared some months to be sacred. No fighting, no killing each other. وَالْهَدِيَ وَالْقَلَائِدِ. In the same way, the animals which are being taken there for sacrifice and who have garlands as a sign in their necks. ذَلِكَ لِتَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهِ يَعْلَمُ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. And this is to emphasize upon you that Allah knows whatever is in the heavens and in the earth. أَنَّ اللَّهِ يَعْلَمُ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٌ. Allah knows everything. Don't think that if nobody is seeing you, you will got free. All these rules you have to keep. Whether you are only single person in the whole wilderness, nobody else is going to see you, but Allah is seeing you. اعلموا أن الله شديد العقاب والله غفور رحيم. I told you, these are the two aspects, two attributes of Allah which must be kept in mind simultaneously. Be it known to you, number one, أن الله شديد العقاب. He is very severe in punishment. وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورُ رَحِيمٌ. And Allah at the same time is غفور, forgiving and merciful. Both these things should be there. So a Muslim's attitude should be somewhere between khauf and raja. The fear of the accountability of the day of judgment, the fear of the punishment of Allah, that should also remain in your mind. But the hope to be forgiven because Allah is forgiving, that should also not vanish from your minds. If the hope, the rope of hope is broken, your heart will break. The intention and the will to amend your ways will be weakened. So, Bainal Khawf wa Raja. There should be hope also. And there should be khawf also. Wa ma'ala Rasool illa al-balagh. There is nothing, no responsibility of our messenger except conveying. Wallahu ya'lamu ma tudduna wa ma taktubuna. And Allah very well knows what you have been doing openly and what you have been doing secretly. قُلْ لَا يَسْتَوِي الْخَبِيثُ وَالطَّيِّبُ وَلَوْ عَجَبَكَ كَثْرَةُ الْخَبِيثِ. Tell, good and bad are not equal. Although the abundance of bad might please you, might appear to you to be very pleasing. I'm earning from haram, but I have money, I have bank balance, I have this thing. Now this is very pleasant. But this is bad. In the end, it's not going to do you any good. It will turn into snakes and scorpions on the day of judgment in the hell. So, قُلْ لَا يَسْتَوِي الْخَبِيثُ وَالطَّيِّبُ. The good and bad, the pure and foul, they are not equal. وَلَوْ أَعْجَبَكَ كَثْرَةُ الْخَبِيثِ. Although the abundance of khabith might be very pleasing, appear to be very pleasant to you. فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ يَا أُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. So have taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Oh, people of understanding. You see how often this taqwa, ittaqu, have taqwa, is repeated in the Quran. This is peculiar to Quran. No, this Quran doesn't give us the sharia in the dry form of books of the law. If you read a legal document, it's very dry, you know. Quran is giving the legal education. All the do's and don'ts are coming. But you know, in what a good manner? With taqwa, with ihsan, good advice, moving words, appealing to your souls also, appealing to your passions also, appealing to your intellect also, appealing to your intelligence, appealing to your understanding also. All these things, the wholesome approach to transform the human character into a good man, a good bondsman of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a good soldier of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the upholder of justice, who becomes witness for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ya ayyuhallazina amanu kunu qawwamina bilqisti shuhada lillah. Ya ayyuhallazina amanu kunu qawwamina lillah shuhada bilqist. May Allah give us the courage to become one of them. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-azim wa nafa'ni wa iyyakum bil ayati wa dhikril hakim.